Executive of Canada. And in about 4 hours, I will become the Executive Director of the Ontario Automotive Recyclers Association in the convention that follows. This event came about over the last couple of years as we in the auto recycling business, we're in a unique industry that we get to look at what's being put on the road today, knowing that that will come to an end of life at some point, maybe 15 years down the road if it's a scrap car, a true end of life. Maybe in 2023 if it's a total loss vehicle, so our members handle all of those types of vehicles. As we got diving into what electrification is, and just trying to understand it all, we spent the last several years just holding our hand up and saying, hey, we're in the business now, we'd like to be in the business in the future, things are going to change, we're a piece of the puzzle, you guys got a piece of the puzzle, how do we talk and learn from one another? And I also have my auto recycling constituents, the members who pay me to do this, and while they are concerned with electrification, it's generally not something that they will worry about on Monday. They worry about staffing and access to cars and selling parts and regulations. And that's really what the OARA conference is all about over the next couple of days. But I had a number of you types of stakeholders saying, well, you must be talking about electric vehicles at the OARA convention. And I'm like, I don't have time there. There's one, it's too big of a field. And it's not something, again, that an auto recycler is going to take back and implement on Monday. Maybe they're going to implement it in 2024 and beyond, and that's why we need to be talking about it now. And that's where this came in. I said, well, you know, I got some time on Thursday afternoon. Why don't I'm going to be at the hotel anyways. Several of you are coming to the OARA convention anyways. You know, why don't I put a roundtable together and start to kind of more publicly talk about, you know, what the issues are that we have, that we know about, that we need to know about. And that's why I sent the invitation out, organized the speakers, and here we are. We have 4 hours, probably not going to solve anything directly in this meeting, but hopefully we'll understand one another a little bit better, and certainly we'll be able to kind of show what we do and what we want to do in the future and some of the gaps that may exist there. So this is a bit of an overview of what we're going to talk about today. So I'm going to talk just generally about what is auto recycling, just so that we have some common understanding of what my members do, you know, what gets them out of bed and hopefully put some money in the till at the end of it all. And I'm going to be turning it over to three speakers that I've worked with over the past several years. Maria Kelleher, who's an environmental consultant and has done work for us on a plastics file and on the EV roadmap that we put together with Jeff Love. And she's going to just talk generally about, you know, what does the EV landscape in Canada look like? That is, again, trying to be as relevant to auto recyclers as we can. Jeff Haltrich from Call to Recycle, you know, we've worked with on a number of levels. He's with the Canadian Vehicle Manufacturers Association, put together a primer for Canada on how ELVs are managed. So he goes into a lot more depth and a lot more research than what we have been able to do. And then we're also going to have Ryan Mandel from CCC talking about the... That's what you get when you forget your introductory notes at home. There's one. Sorry, Ryan. Who is, from a data perspective, sort of the intersection of auto recycling, collision repair, and insurance. And you'll see why those sectors are so important to auto recyclers. Insurers have cars and are integral in the parts acquisition that collision repairers do, and obviously collision repairers are the guys who are buying parts, you know, hopefully recycled. If that market falls apart because electric vehicles are not repairable, are totaled at an extensive rate, whatever those issues are, those are economic factors that we need to understand. And then I'm going to be doing a little bit of interspersing. We got a small contract with Natural Resources Canada And we had Jeff Love and Maria and some consultants help develop a roadmap for our industry. And it's sort of, again, who are we? What do we do? We surveyed our members in terms of what they understand about what EVs are all about, and came up with some actionable items that I can kind of overview out there. Gonna have a coffee break, and then it's really roundtable stuff. So, yeah, we'll entertain some questions with the presenters, you know, if it works that way. But we'll also have the back half of the day to just talk about what you heard, probe further on things that you need to know about. I know many, if not all of you, in the audience as to why you're here. So I may call on you as to, you know, help explain, you know, your industry's perspective on something. So, I think this is Maria's chart from some of the presentations she's made. And that little box is where the auto recycler sits in the ecosystem of electrification. And really, you know, part of the reason for us to do this is that nobody's really looking at the on-road service, repair, end-of-life side of electrification. They dabble in it, but obviously it's core to us. Mining, battery manufacturing, assembly, charging, and consumer incentives, you know, all those issues are being, in my opinion, well handled by the Canadian government, by those companies and stakeholders within it. But that on-road piece is not, there's the dabble in it all. And that's really why we wanted to have the discussion. So a bit of background on auto recycling. There's about 1.6 million end-of-life vehicles in Canada in your average year. It's been as low as a million, probably been as high as 2 million. Nobody keeps track of it in an organized fashion. The auto recyclers of Canada, which I represent, is made up of 7 provincial associations. We have about 350 working auto recyclers, so companies that take apart cars for parts and materials. There's thought to be about 1,600 ICE, so internal combustion engine, auto dismantlers across Canada. So they're identified, they're cited, they may be licensed, but somebody's identified them. And that's an understatement in terms of who's actually in the sector. Because it's estimated that it's double that number in terms of the illicit, unlicensed, sort of just dabbling in the industry. So you can drive around anywhere in Toronto, look at a signpost and cash for your car, top dollar paid. Chances are it's not an actual auto recycler, how we would define it, in that they're cited, they have a location, they're licensed, they're identified by their government, but they exist. And it has implications for electrification as they move down. There are about 1,000 scrap processors. Again, we have scrap people in the audience who may not know that number better than I, who may touch an ICE vehicle at some point in time. But they're generally a little bit further down the path in terms of the economics of those cars. So they're basically looking at it, how much does it weigh? We're looking at it, how much does it weigh and what kind of parts can be extracted from it all. And there is a complete sector out there on a global basis looking at, is that car repairable or can go back on the road anywhere around the globe? So an auto dismantler, which is essentially what I represent, is a company that buys end-of-life vehicles for its parts and materials, with parts being primary. And it's a continuum. There's probably no 100% parts within our sector. You know, someone like Michael Carconi might be 90% of his sales are parts. All the way down to some people that might be only 10%. They're only taking the battery and the tires, and there's everybody in between. It is a very populous field with anyone in a number of different niches. But for the most part, we're putting our hands on the car, taking it apart, doing the depollution, and touching it. On the scrap side, again, it tends to be more weight. How much does that car weigh? And they are depolluting it, hopefully, and kind of removing those operating fluids. But they oftentimes don't have the capacity at this point in time to stop, understand what that battery is, because that's the new component, and do something with it all. So they're, we're all part of the same industry. There's no real segmentation other than, you know, how do you look at the car at end of life? Based on the research that we did within our membership in terms of, you know, are you processing EVs at this point in time? And it was about 50% of our members were. Actually, it was in the 40%, I think, were processing EVs in some capacity. And that's a year ago survey. So just kind of extrapolating it out, there's probably only 350 dismantlers who are processing or capable of processing EVs. And again, using the same math on how many from our survey on the scrap side are processing EVs, it might be only 25. You know, they might be seeing a few of them, but for the most part, the feedback we're getting from the pure scrap industry is, I don't want to touch those things. I don't quite understand them. I don't understand the economics of them. And I don't have the information to do it safely. And as much as 30% of an EV that is a total loss is exported. It goes somewhere around the world because that country maybe has more information. Probably more likely it has less regulation as to what they do with that vehicle. But cars are a global commodity. They don't stay in Canada just because they are from Canada. They move around. A couple of points on ICE versus EVs. You know, to remove a lead acid battery, take the operating fluids out, you could probably do it in 30 minutes in terms of the proper depollution. Removing an EV battery is a much more complex process, especially when they're built right into the vehicle. Heavier, more powerful, and every OEM takes a different approach to the safety mechanisms that they build into it all. And you know, people call for, well, shouldn't the OEs have one standard battery with one standard system? But that's not how they work. That's not how they compete. That's not how they design. So it is a much more difficult process to remove that battery. And the one thing that I want to remind people is that an auto recycler looks at the whole car. So as much as this is an electrification, this is the EV that we're processing, whenever I talk to people about this subject, they immediately go to the battery. They just want to talk about the battery. Well, the battery is new. The battery is dangerous. The battery is uncertainty behind it all. But the battery is in a car, and we look at the whole car. And as soon as you start separating out parts from the car, you break the economics of why or who's touching that vehicle. Every auto dismantler with an ICE vehicle, engine, transmission, so the drivetrains are the number one sellers. That's really what covers a huge chunk of their sales. And that's gonna change. These are different power mechanisms involved. The engines, the transmissions, they're smaller, they're infinitely more simpler. You know, what is the rebuilding opportunity with those? What is the ability for those things to need replacing? There's just not a lot of data out there right now. So that makes auto recyclers very nervous. My core business model of how I survive and do and invest and train is built around that drivetrain, and that's going to change an electric vehicle. At one point in time, you know, the EV batteries were thought to be lasting 5 to 10 years. Hey, don't buy an EV, you're going to have to replace the battery in 5 years, it costs you $20,000. I read it on the internet, I saw it on YouTube. So that's changing. Batteries are getting infinitely more sophisticated, more powerful, different chemistries, different things happening to them. So I think the modern approach to the battery now is that the battery is going to outlive the car. The car itself will shake apart, rust, however they're going to fail. The battery is thought not to fail. So what do you do with that big, scary thing that now is considered to be an asset by some people? And you just have to look at what OEs are doing in terms of testing the battery potential for reuse, repurposing. You know, how do you extract value? They're not in the reuse business, but they are in the value business for sure. And a lot of people are pointing towards that second life. You know, you hear it all the time. You know, part of the electrification, overall societal electrification, is harnessing batteries as energy storage to supplement wind and solar. And there's a lot of micro looks and installations on those second life batteries coming from vehicles. They're not purpose built that way, but there are companies coming up, and there's some of them here today, who are making a business of figuring out how do you take these batteries and turn them into something valuable for us, a completely different consumer sector. And that's the point, the last one on the complete vehicle. So the little mercury pellets, the mercury switches that were in vehicles up to 93, was it? Mandated to be removed from the vehicle on behalf of the manufacturer to do it all. So the manufacturers came to us and said, hey, you need to get those mercury switches. They're like, well, we don't touch all cars. There's a whole economy that touches the car, so it's difficult for us to grab every mercury switch because we're not the only people buying these cars. And that was a case where, hey, we don't care where the car goes, all we want is the little pellets. It's an example of when you separate out a part of the vehicle from the vehicle, you really change the economics of it all. I don't know if you can read that quote. I read that one yesterday. It was in a McKinsey study that came out. And basically, trying to look at it optimistically, I think our sector is I'll say pessimistic on the issue, but they're extremely worried about electrification and what it will do to their staff, their sales opportunities. But there are a lot of optimistic things happening, and this is a sector that continually figures out how to deal with what is going on the road. And when they first come on the road, you know, we look at them and go, wow, that's unibody, what are we going to do with that? You know, no carburetor, oh no. They figure it out, they dabble, they play, they love cars, and you know, there are a lot of smart people looking at them, and a lot of different sectors kind of looking at us going, you guys are going to have a lot of batteries at some point in time. Well, we have a lot of batteries right now, because again, we're processing a lot of total loss vehicles. So I am going to stop there.